Today I'm going to be speaking a message entitled, God is Calling. God is Calling. How will He call? Number of different ways. I doubt that your phone's going to ring and He's going to talk on the other end of that. But God has a lot of marvelous ways that He can speak to us. And I want to address that subject this morning. And I want to start off with something that happened Wednesday night. We were studying the book of Matthew on Wednesday night. An interesting thing about the book of Matthew is that that's the only book where the phrase, the kingdom of heaven, appears. And it does appear there 32 times, according to my count. And that's the only place it appears. And I made a statement about one of the times that Jesus said to His disciples, He sort of just pointed to them. I think He did. Maybe pointed to one of His disciples, and He said, the kingdom of heaven is within you. Well, actually, I was a little wrong on that. He said, the kingdom of God is within you. So it lives within our bosom by faith in Christ. But someone asked me that going out the door that evening. You know, they said, where is that at? And so I asked Siri on my phone, as I often do. I often ask Siri, you know, certain things if I just want to find it real quick like that. And I took a screenshot of this, so I've got it right here, and it's so cool what she answered when I said, Siri, where did Jesus say the kingdom of heaven is within you? And so she says, let me think on that a minute, Tim. And so she does, and about 2 seconds later, she comes back and says, sorry, Tim, I don't see Jesus in your contacts. It's really not good as a preacher when Jesus is not in your contacts. So I haven't done it yet, but you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make a contact with just Jesus' name. And I'm going to put location, heaven, phone number, prayer. So Siri will never make that charge again against me. So Jesus is not in my contacts. My question to you, is He in your contacts? And that's an interesting idea, and while we laugh at it, but I wonder how many people in this world, if the Lord contacted them, would they recognize Him? Would they recognize His voice? Would they know who they were listening to? That's a real good question. Because today I want to make this statement, God is calling. God is calling the unsaved unto salvation. And God is calling the saved into what I call a progressive sanctification. And God is always calling the sanctified into a place of service. And so I believe that His call comes to us at various times, on different levels, and He is impressive if we have the ears to hear when He calls. Father in heaven, thank You so much for the privilege to speak Your word today. God, we thank You for the privilege to know You, to hear You, to receive from heaven the call of God. And I ask that this day, truly, You will always be, from this moment on, for all of us, in our contacts. And that, God, You will contact us, not periodically, but daily. And we will contact You daily. And that, Father, this conversation will never close. This conversation will never end from this point throughout the endless ages of eternity. May, God, You continue to speak now, as You have already in this service preceding this message. May You now speak to us directly. We'll thank You and praise You for all You do in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. Amen. God is calling. Is anyone listening? And so how does He call? Well, I believe in a number of ways God speaks to people. But the most profound, and I think the most precise way that He speaks to us is through this. God has given us an entire book. We call it the Bible. It's also called a letter. It's a series of 66 letters that God wrote over about 1,650 years of time, from all kinds of circumstance and situations, sometimes to a people, sometimes to a nation, sometimes to a church, and sometimes to an individual. And in all of this letter of love from God, there's amazing detail. God speaks to us in general, and God speaks to us specifically. And there are times in settings like this when we read God's word, when we preach God's word, it becomes so personal, it becomes so pertinent to every single heart that is open. There's a passage in the book of Ephesians, that will be my text for today. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 5 and verse 14, where Paul said this, wherefore, he's quoting, but he said, wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepeth, arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. What a message. Because that's the text on October the 15th, Friday night, October the 15th, 1937, in a little church near Livermore, Kentucky, where my father had been kind of pressured to go that night. That the preacher read that, and God began to call a man to himself. And that man was my father, who that night responded to the call, whose life was transformed, who would pick up this book and preach it, who would have seven children, of whom I am one. And God's message was received, God's call was received, and a man's life was changed, and the world beyond that point, at least to some extent, was changed dramatically. God speaks through the scripture. It's a letter of love to him, from him to us. It is a letter of warning. It's a letter of instruction, a letter of revelation, not only for the sinner, but also for the saint. And it's a letter of urgency. God speaks to us in urgent terms many times. Paul, quoting the Old Testament, said, today is the day. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of progressive sanctification. Today is the day of service. And oh, how direct his message comes to you. God speaks to you through the scripture. But God also speaks to you through the saints. Now, I've often told you, and lately we've dwelt on this some, that if you're saved, you are a saint. God calls you that. I don't. I only call you that because God calls you that. I know you pretty good. But because God says you're a saint, I say you're a saint. And God calls people through his people. You know, once you got it, you can give it. Once you know him, you can speak as you know him. And God uses people. That's why that he called us into this ministry. That's why he sent us out into all the world. That's why David's going to France. That's why we are here in this church, in this community, reaching out to people, because God calls people, not just through the scripture, but he calls people through the saints. You know, some people will never pick up this book. They will never listen to it or read it, but they read you. They know you. They come to know you by way of association. Sometimes it's voluntary, sometimes it's involuntary. Have you ever wished that you could pick the family into which you was born? I'm glad you didn't have that choice. God picked that for you. Now, you do accept a job and you go to work. That's voluntary. And you rub shoulders with people. And you go to work every day because most of you like to eat every day. Amen? So you have to make a living, and you rub shoulders with people, and you have a chance to influence them. God calls people through the saints' prayers. Paul said, I exhort you therefore that first of all, supplications and prayers and intercession and the giving of thanks be made for all men. God wants us to pray for people. And when we pray for people, it makes a difference. When you call someone's name to God, you care enough to do that. God hears it. God moves upon it. And God touches their heart. God calls through not only our prayers, but through our preaching. You say, well, that's what you're doing now, and that's true, but yet every single one of us preach a message with our life. While your testimony's precious and valuable to God, and as you live it out in front of people and as you speak it oftentimes, it makes a dent. It makes an impression. You say, oh, not mine, but it does. And God's capable of using that in so many wonderful ways. We all have a message. And that message is Christ. And He comes through our practice. And that's another way. God calls people when we practice our faith. And this faith is more than concept. It's more than an idea. It's a reality of life for us as we practice the things that God has taught us. Oh, the practice of the faith. That's why Peter said, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. And be ready. He said, be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Now, if anybody's going to ask you that, they've been watching you practice it. We need to practice it and practice it well. And then Paul said also there's proof. You know, we have to live to prove what it is we believe. To the Romans, he said, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You think, you say God is good? Prove it. You say God's grace is wonderful, amazing grace? Prove it. You say you love God? Prove it. And the privilege we have is that we can. Is that we can trust and obey. We can live and learn and love and actually prove to a world. This is more than concept. This is more than theory. This is a reality for me. I love God. He loves me. And that makes me different. There's nothing good about me. There's nothing wonderful about Tim Hall. The only thing I have is him. And he takes what little I have and makes it so much more. One day he took a little boy's lunch. The little boy thought it was just enough for him. But he found out that it was enough to feed 5,000 people when it got into the hands of Jesus. Now what do you have? What do you have to offer Jesus? You say, oh, less than that. But he can take so little and make it so much. God calls people through Scripture, but he also calls them through the saints. And then I think God calls people all the time. I see it every week in my life and in other people's lives. God is calling upon people through the situations of their life. Like a time of trouble. There's nothing like a time of trouble that opens the gateway for God to speak. When we get trouble, we start looking around, we start trying to figure it out, we start listening. I mean, all our radar, our antennas go up. When we're hurting, we're so open to listening and hearing. Maybe not what God is saying, but just any answer at all. And God takes advantage of those opportunities. Where did Jesus go? I mean, when the Lord came and launched his ministry, when he stood up in Nazareth and said, this day this scripture is fulfilled. What scripture? The scripture from Isaiah that said the Messiah was sent to do this and this and this and this. Where did he go? He went to the brokenhearted. He went to those whose hearts needed healing. He went to the blind. He went to the destitute. He went to the troubled. Because they were ready. They were ready. God speaks in times of situations, times of trouble. He speaks when people feel helpless, like Jonah. How helpless do you think Jonah felt when down in the belly of a whale didn't have a light or a lantern, and he had a seaweed wrapped around his head and sloshing around in the acidic juices of a big fish's belly? No chance, no chance of getting out of there. He felt helpless. And God spoke to him, and he spoke to God. God speaks through situations. When you're lonely, listen. God is speaking. I think he says, I'm a friend that will stick closer to you than a brother. Trust me. And though no one else is with you, I am with you. God is always with you. He'll speak when you feel you have nothing left. In times of what I call emptiness, God's voice is clear during those times. Like Naomi. You know, her husband probably made a bad choice when he left Bethlehem of Judea, went down into the country of Moab. He got a job, but he died there. His sons died there. And Naomi came back with nothing. You know what she said? She said, Don't call me what you once called me, which meant full. He said, because I'm bitter. She said, I'm bitter. I have nothing left. I'm empty. She did come back with Ruth, however. And that was going to change everything. But God spoke to her during those days, as he will you. And then I think that God speaks to us in times of sorrow. This world is so full of sorrow. It cannot even be estimated how much sorrow this very day is being felt by people. I heard just a moment ago that Barbara Hudnall went on out. She just found out she had cancer in such a way there was nothing the doctors could do at this point. You know what she said? She said, you know, I'm 83. I've had a good life. I think I'm just going to take what God gives me and just go on to heaven. Isn't that great? I mean, to have that kind of faith and that kind of trust in the Lord, and we only got to fellowship with her here in our church for just a little while, but hey, now she's in heaven. She's with God. Such a wonderful time. But you know, she's got a son, Tim, and a daughter, Sheila. I went to school with Sheila, high school with Sheila. I've come to meet Tim and know him a little. And, you know, there's a sorrow in their heart today. And God speaks during times of sorrow, especially when we lose a loved one. And for one, like Barbara, it's almost a relief to know that, you know, her body's not racked with pain anymore. She's with the Lord, but she still leaves an empty place here for them. But I read a story one time about a man in Chicago. He was wealthy. He was successful in his business. This is a true story. About how one day his wife got sick and the doctors could not help and he lost her. But they'd been privileged to have a beautiful little daughter. She was such a precious child. And so all of his energy and all of his time that he had outside his business was put into that girl. And she got to go into church, and she would invite her dad. She said, Dad, I love Sunday school. Would you go with me? And like many successful people, he wanted to. He even planned to at some point. But boy, Sunday was the only day he had to just collect everything and sort everything out and relax a little bit. He said, honey, I'll go with you, but I just can't go today. And as life would have it for him, as life often has it for us, she got sick. The doctors couldn't help her either. And she died. And he came home after the funeral. And he walked through that house. It was large. He had been blessed in many ways. But it was so empty now without her voice. It was so empty now without her laughter. He no longer heard in reality. He heard it in memory, her footsteps all over that house. Now she'd jump into his bed at night and hug and kiss him. And he would read to her, and she was all he had. And he got bitter and got angry that night. He had already thought the thoughts about why God would need her if there really was a God. I mean, really, how does a man like me lose my wife and then lose my daughter? I have nothing. All that money can buy, but I have nothing. And it's funny how the nicest things of this world can all of a sudden just seem empty. Because life's about people, you know. Life's about God. It's about relationships. And when those are gone, I mean, what is there? I mean, what's the purpose? What's the reason? He couldn't sleep. He paced back and forth in his bedroom. And finally, out of sheer exhaustion, he just falls down across his bed and just passes out in exhaustion. But while he's sleeping, he has this dream. He has this dream. And he sees himself on the side of a river, and across the river and down the way there's a city, and it's well lit. And he's just standing there, and he's just looking across the river. And he sees some people from the city running toward him. And they're dressed in white, and their hair is blowing in the wind. And he said, they're just running straight toward him. And he's just frozen in that moment as he watches. But as they get closer, he notices the lead little person is his daughter. And she comes down to the bank of the river, and she says, Daddy, come over here. Daddy, come over here. And he wakes up. And he slides down beside his bed, and he says, God, if you're real, if my daughter's with you, I want to come there too. And like most of us that can't explain that experience, that night, an enormous burden lifted off of his shoulders. That night, Christ set up residence in his heart. He stood up, a new man, a new person, and he knew that God was real. More real than he'd ever dreamed possible. So real that his interest in business waned quite a bit after that. In fact, he came to a decision not long after. He said, I'm just going to sell my business. And he sold it. He had a lot of money. And he began to invest that in different ways. But one of the main ways he invested it, he lived in Chicago. One of the best ways he invested it was that he bought some houses and remodeled them and maybe larger buildings, and he began to house a lot of the homeless people, especially the little girls. And every little girl he saw on the streets of Chicago, he saw the face of his daughter. And he found the greatest purpose of life at that moment to reach out and to make a difference in the world. He died the happiest man he could have ever been. Why? Because God speaks through sorrow. When we have a loss of purpose, a loss of everything, loss of confidence, God speaks through those things. So God speaks through Scripture. He speaks through the saints. He speaks through situations. He speaks through sorrow. But the greatest way he speaks is that he speaks through the Savior. You see, the greatest statement God ever made is when Jesus came to Bethlehem. The greatest thing that God ever said to the world is, I love you, and here's how, here's why. I sent my son to be with you. And he was born, he grew to be a man, he launched his ministry. It was all about you, it was all about us. Lord never worked a miracle for himself, but he worked plenty for you and people like you. He never worked a miracle to feed himself, but one day he fed 5,000 and another day he fed 4,000 from nothing and made it stretch. The greatest message ever is through the Savior. You know how that comes? Comes through this, but it comes right here too. In a still, small voice, God speaks to us. Just like Elijah heard that day when he felt all was lost, but God led him to a place where God spoke to him in a still, small voice. It's a persistent voice. It comes over and over again. Even when we don't listen at first, he keeps coming to us. He was there all the time. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 20 says, wisdom, it's crying outside. God's voice is crying outside. She utters her voice in the streets. Really. She cries in the chief places of concourse where the busiest of places are. God's there. He's talking to people. God is calling through the voice of his Son. And it's a constant presence. Every church you pass, every Christmas season, every Easter season, symbols and servants of God everywhere, his presence is constantly around you. God is calling. Is anybody listening? You know, there's this song. I guess it's an invitation song. It goes, I can hear my Savior calling. I can hear my Savior calling. And oh, how he calls. What a tender, what a precious, what a personal message when it comes. I love this song, and I've mentioned it lately before, but it was written back in the 70s, the early 70s, by Lanny Wolf. And Lanny was a part of what's called the Lanny Wolf Trio, back in the early 70s, and he wrote this song entitled Whatever It Takes. Whatever It Takes. And they would travel around, and of course they'd have big singings, and one time they went to a place in what's called the Golden Triangle of Texas. There's three towns there that I know one of them's name is Beaumont, because the trio went to this place called the Beaumont City Auditorium, a big crowd, and there was a man and his wife there that night. His name was Ken Raggio, and his wife Dixie, and they went that night in the summer of 1975, and they heard Lanny sing this song, among other songs. So they bought a bunch of the music tapes, and they went back to their church, and they thought, you know, he was starting a church in the Golden Triangle. This Ken Raggio was starting a church. He was a church planner. And so they wanted to do some of this music, and they went to try to learn these songs, and when they came to this one, Whatever It Takes, this is what Ken said to his wife, Dixie. He said, I don't know if I'm ready to sing this song. I was somewhat reluctant for fear of what a consecration this intensity might eventually require. But he said, we both knew it was right. He said, I don't know that I'm ready to sing this song. Let me read it to you. It starts out this way. There's a voice calling me from an old rugged tree, and he whispers, draw closer to me. Leave this world far behind. There are new heights to climb, and a new place in me you will find. And so the verse voice is God speaking to us. There's a voice calling me, and he says, draw closer to me. And then the chorus goes like this. Whatever it takes to draw closer to you, Lord, that's what I'm willing to do. For whatever it takes to be more like you, that's what I'll be willing to do. But the final three verses, this is what calls Ken Raggio to say, I don't know that I'm ready to sing this song. Because here's what it says. Take the dearest things to me, if that's how it must be, to draw me closer to thee. Let the disappointments come, lonely days without the sun, if through sorrow more like you I become. Verse 3. Take my houses and my lands, change my dreams, change my plans, for I'm placing my whole life in your hands. And if you call me today to a place far away, Lord, I'll go, and your will I'll obey. Verse 4. I'll trade sunshine for rain, comfort for pain. That's what I'll be willing to do. For whatever it takes for my will to break, that's what I'll be willing to do. And Ken Raggio said to his wife Dixie, a preacher, a church planner, said, I don't know that I'm ready to sing this song. I just think that would be, he was being honest, and I appreciate that in him. But I think that's what a lot of people would say if they were honest. Because that's saying a lot. There's a voice calling me from an old rugged tree, and he whispers, draw closer to me. Leave this world far behind. There are new heights to climb. And a new place in me you will find. Whatever it takes. God is calling. Is anybody listening? Father, thank you. Thank you for this moment. And I think along with Ken Raggio, we have to consider, are we ready to sing that song? Thank you, Lord. There were some disciples long ago who left their ships and left their nets. And they said, I'm ready to sing that song. Thank you, Father, for a man, my father, back in October of 37, who said he was willing to sing that song. Thank you for other people in my life that influenced me so deeply, who said somewhere along the way they were willing to sing that song. And thank you, God, that one night, almost 40 years ago now, in fact, next month it will be, 40 years for me, when I tried to sing that song one night, I did sing that song one night. And from my heart, I meant it. But Lord, a lot of time has come and gone. We think we grow up. We think we get professional. We just need to revisit it. Because, Lord, you're calling today. You are calling